Welcome to the Executive Insights Podcast, brought to you by AWS. I'm Clark Rogers, Director of Enterprise Strategy, and I'll be your guide through a series of conversations with security leaders. Today, we're joined by my colleague, Chris Hennesey, former IT CFO in the financial services industry. Join us as we discuss the CISO-CFO relationship, making cybersecurity investments, and generative AI in the finance realm. Please enjoy. Chris, thanks so much for joining me today.
So excited to be here, Clark.
So you are a unique guest on the Conversations with Security Leaders because you're in fact not a security leader at AWS, but you have a strong background as a CFO. Could you share a little bit about that?
Yeah, Clark, I love, as we work together now, my background is as a technology CFO. So I've worked a lot with security leaders. So I spent over two decades within a financial service company and was able to think through what are the best ways to engage inside of an organization? How do you make the right level of investments inside of technology? And how do you get the value that's expected? So a lot of exposure to security, but specifically not deeply in the security org. But I think the spirit of what happens within it is very consistent across the company, which is how do we deliver value? How do we potentially mitigate costs and exposure as you go through managing through an organization?
Right. And as we've discussed, the CISO-CFO relationship is often overlooked as an asset from the CISO's perspective. It may also be from the CFO perspective as well. But when I talk to CISOs, they're often so focused on the security and the risk details, they don't realize that they have a strong ally in the CFO office.
Yeah. As I've reflected on this, I think there's a lot of similarities, even though they feel slightly different. CISO organizations tend to be small and mighty inside of it. It's kind of embedded and federated in terms of the responsibility of security. That's very consistent with finance as well. They're smaller teams in the grand scheme of organizations, and they rely on a federated control environment around how they manage. So it's consistency there. I think they also are focusing on ensuring they're being really well managed. Risk management is a huge deal for both personas. While they manage different risks, the frameworks, the governance, and the approach is very consistent. And I think there's tight relationships. The other is they both have a bird's eye view of the entire organization,
right?
The risk landscape. And I think that's one reason that attracted me personally to finance is having that corporate or enterprise view of what's happening enables you to have context to then make informed decisions. And I think that's true for CISOs as well.
100%. So if we looked at some practical advice, what is a good pitch from a CISO to the CFO when that, you know, that a CISO wants to make an investment to ideally lower risk throughout the organization? How do you like to be approached with those kind of conversations?
Typically, in a lot of companies that I've had experience with, a lot of leaders within technology under tremendous pressure to deliver. They're maintaining a lot of systems. There's a desire to enhance and improve and develop new features. There's just a lot of demands. And usually with more demands, there's a desire for more capacity. So a lot of times people, when they approach a CFO or approach me, they are thinking everything is incremental. You can't touch the core, you can't touch the base. I need more. My advice would be is to think about almost zero sum some of the elements of what they're doing, provide transparency around what their organization focuses on, what risks they're mitigating, obviously celebrating wins and sharing insights around one of the big things with security. A lot of this is around cost avoidance and cost mitigation and risk mitigation. And that's sometimes not easy to quantify in all cases. Some of it's qualitative, some of it's quantitative, but I think it's a big deal in terms of the conversation of framing this up. I know I always appreciated as CISOs have just such a unique perspective of the stories they could tell. The things that almost nobody knows inside of the organization that's happening inside of it, especially in a highly regulated entity, there's so much that happens you just don't appreciate. So if I would approach a CFO as a CISO, I would frame out the organization, be clear on the value they're delivering, or maybe have some stories or use cases of the ways in which they've mitigated risks as a part of it. But also just be a good steward of their funds that they're provided. Although they may have smaller teams, they also need to be good financial stewards inside of an organization. And some of the best allies I had across all of technology, and many of them being CISOs, is they hold people accountable inside of their organization. It's not all of, I need more tools, I need more software, I need more coverage. It's how do I rationalize what I have? What trade-offs would I make? I mean, may not want to make that trade-off,
right,
but I have thought through what that may mean. So those would be a couple of tips that I would share as a part of it.
And diving a little bit deeper on that, you know, the ask for a new tool, for example, do you, if you don't see it listed in the ask, do you automatically ask, well, how are you going to run the tool? Are you staffed for the tool? Because oftentimes what we see is customers buying a tool and they don't understand that the staffing and the operational aspects of it are needed. That costs money. It's either the cost of not doing something else or it's hiring new staff. How do you approach that?
Yeah, I think it depends on the technical fluency of the CFO. Right. Obviously, if it's an IT or technology CFO, they probably are aware, but the framework a lot would think about is there's investments to be made, and then there's something called the investment tail. It's what continues on after the investment. So maintenance, depreciation, all the things that come with the support of that. And I think I know from my vantage point, what I was always curious and asking about was, if you needed new coverage, new software, new capability, I would always ask, why don't you have that today? Is there coverage that exists with existing tools?
Right.
Really start pushing on some of the architecture and target architecture decisions to, do we need yet another tool, another framework? Many times in security, the answer is yes, because there's you know, so much fast-paced technology evolution. But I met with one customer and a CFO who's getting fairly frustrated about the ask for more software. It was like a one in, one out. Happy for you to bring this in. Which one are you going to remove? So really think through technical debt, the sprawl of software that exists, but really being really mindful of it's not just more, more, more. We need to also rationalize apps and infrastructure that we're not leveraging.
Very, very helpful and insightful. Some of the conversations I have with CISOs are around, how do I report cyber risk to the board, right? And there's two sides of that. There's the CISO side, what language should I speak to the board in terms of risk? And then there's the board side of, what questions should I be asking the CISO? To the degree that it happens, how often is the CFO involved in cyber risk discussions, because there's clearly a financial element of it. There may be the literal cyber insurance, right? Someone has to write a check for that ongoing premium, et cetera. So how often does that happen, and where would you insert yourself in those types of conversations?
Yeah. I think many boards have audit and risk committees, and CFOs and cyber play an active role in managing that, although different risks. So I think it would be an active engagement, but sometimes it's hard to really be knowledgeable in all the risks that exist out there. What are the right questions to ask in that regard? I know a lot of CFOs, corporate level CFOs, may not know a lot about the technical dynamics of things. So there may be an apprehension to ask questions unless they're deeply curious and want to dive deeper into it. So I think it depends on the CFO. I think that committee is a great forcing function for them to be partners together with the board. But there's a spectrum, as you know, there's probably a spectrum of CISOs where some will deeply lean in and fully appreciate and understand it, especially some of the reputational risk considerations of this. Obviously, some of the tactical things of what's our coverage and insurance, it doesn't take long until you go through a large breach or a cyber attack or something else where all the C-suite's going to be very engaged in this.
Correct.
So you'd rather prevent that from happening and not have to live through that. But I think there's a spectrum. My experience is CFOs are very curious. They want to learn, but they know they can't be an expert in everything. So they also deeply lean on their CISO at those times as well.
So again, in the conversations with the board, a topic that comes up quite a bit is ransomware, right? How long can we be locked out of our systems and still function? At what point would we have to consider either closing up shop, paying the ransom, et cetera? Do you see CFOs getting involved in those conversations?
Yeah, I luckily have not gone through a ransomware attack in terms of to that scale. I think that level of planning, I think there could be, especially at an enterprise level, CFO engagement.
Incident response planning.
Yeah, because even think tactically, depending on when this happened, it could influence your external filings, regulatory reporting, all the things CFOs care about that are vital to the way in which they need to operate. Obviously, the customer, depending on the business, the customer's ability to use whatever that product may be. But there's a lot of financial considerations. So I think the CFO will lean in pretty heavily, not only in their hat of what is going on with the organization, but what's also going on with the constituents that they lean into
right.
and the regulatory bodies that they have to lean into as well.
Good points. Switching gears a little bit. As you know, generative AI has been a hot topic over the last 12 to 18 months. I've seen CISOs sort of go from, how do I secure generative AI inside our walls, right? Yep. So they're buying a third-party product, they're using Amazon Bedrock, something like that. How do I make that as a secure experience as possible? And now we're seeing the transition from how do I use Gen AI to secure things, right? Mm-hmm. So as part of a security tool or part of the security apparatus. What are your conversations like with CFOs around generative AI? How are they looking at it either from an investment perspective? Because you know, a lot of the times we want generative AI, but we don't really know what we want to do with it. But it costs money either way to experiment.
Yeah, I think, again, there tends to be two perspectives. One is the CFO's role in influencing the organization. Most CFOs are wanting to make sure there's a deep prioritization and focus around use cases. I know a lot of times we'll meet with customers and we have 100 use cases, 200 use cases. So narrowing that down, understanding where the opportunity is, where's the expected value. I think to your point, the question, there's a little bit of a mystique around what's the cost of generative AI, not just what you're paying for an LLM or for right. Bedrock or such, but what's the cumulative effect of what that may be at scale across an enterprise.
Right.
There's obviously, as you mentioned, the data security and risk considerations. A lot of when I meet with CFOs, I'm always curious, especially on the productivity side within finance, that's the other lens they have, is you could change the way in which you work.
Sure.
Inside of finance, there's a ton of commentary management. There's a ton of investor relations prep. I know I heard one customer who was prepping for their board meeting and leveraged generative AI as a way to anticipate questions, prepare right. for that, answer that in a way. So I think there's a lot of power, but a lot of regulated entities are concerned of what is our right security posture around that data. So they're a little bit slower right now to leverage it until their company evolves their strategy. But I think as many of us engage with generative AI outside of the workplace, there's a ton of excitement
yep.
around what's the art of the possible, the way in which you can leverage it. And that's making its way into the workplace and into finance teams. So I think there's a lot of pressure in probably C-suite, not only from board members, but also from the ground up in terms of the organization, because it's really exciting to see what it can do, what it's likely to do in mm-hmm. the next 12 to 18 months yep. as we look ahead. I know I get really excited every time there's a new release in beta and seeing and imagining what that could mean, especially given the finance processes. But I would say it's still early days for a lot of CFOs. They want to understand the case, what's the value prop, especially given a lot of labor efficiency is mm-hmm. on the front end of productivity. What do you do with that? How do you redeploy that? How do you maybe pivot to where there's higher value activities? But we know there's going to be collectively a ton of new products and services that businesses will develop as a part of this. So that could mean new revenue streams as yeah. well. So I think a lot of CFOs are getting excited around how do we do this in a way that can be advantageous for our shareholders, if we're private, our owners, and for government agencies accomplishing the mission that they have and the right. way in which they're doing it.
Love it. So, you know, as we know, technology, there's a human element to all of it. How should a CISO who doesn't have a relationship with their CFO, how should that CISO start approaching it? Do you have any yeah. guidelines?
Yeah, I think usually when you have smaller teams within IT, a lot of CFOs will focus on the larger teams mm-hmm. and ones that where there's a little more noise. So you don't want to be forgotten into the side. I think fostering a personal relationship and professional relationship is key. Although there's some similarities, the deep knowledge expert of both roles are very unique. So I think creating some awareness around what are the problems and challenges that you're having in your organization? What are the ways in which I can be an advocate for you, especially because mm-hmm. they're in a lot of these conversations
yeah, yeah.
together, C-level conversations, board level, audit and risk committee. I think having that collective partnership is a great one, because a lot of CISOs are growing. I've looked at a lot of budgets across customers when I talk to them about IT spend, and CISO orgs are growing at a pretty fast clip relative to other parts of IT.
Okay.
Because the risk profile is growing, there's opportunities that you need to safeguard. So when you're growing at that rate, sometimes there'll be a perception of, I can get what I need. If I need more, I'll get more. So I think CISOs who have a mindset, knowing that it's critical what they're doing, but also being really good disciplined stewards
right.
of this. So even the small things, and I know every company's different, but how am I holding people around headcount accountable?
Yep.
Am I hiring at the pace in which I can? When do I leverage third-party vendors or consultants? needs, even down to the discretionary items. Am I being a good steward through that? And am I helping my team be accountable? So those are some best practices around that. I also love the notion of really inviting the CFO in to help maybe help think through to bring a different perspective to problems you're trying to solve. They obviously likely won't get into the deep technical aspects, but you may be framing out an opportunity or a new risk area or something. How should I think about this? What's the best way to do that? And I think all of this is reciprocal as well. So the CFO should be actively engaging with the CISO, increasing their technical knowledge, understanding what's around the corner.
Right.
How do we plan for this from a capital allocation or investment allocation standpoint? So I think there's a partnership opportunity that's there. But a lot of this is just taking the first step, being comfortable to reach out and fostering a relationship with each other.
Awesome. Chris, thanks so much for your insights today.
Appreciate it. Thanks so much, Clark.